You've probably heard about control and data planes before. Juniper was one of the companies that pioneered these concepts, and they do an amazing job of putting it into practice. This video will discuss what these planes are and how they're used in a practical sense. So what are the control and data planes? To put it simply, each network device is separated into two logical parts. One part, called the data plane, focuses on forwarding traffic from one location to another. The other part, called the control plane, is responsible for managing traffic sent to or from the device. This includes routing protocol traffic, management traffic, and so on. This is not unique to Juniper. Control and data planes are concepts that apply to all modern network devices. When a switch or router is forwarding traffic, it passes through the data plane, also known as the forwarding plane. Does this use any special hardware? Sort of, but not exactly. A plane is a logical concept which explains how traffic is handled. When traffic comes into a switch, for example, it likely needs to be forwarded out to another location. This is called transit traffic, as it is transiting through the switch. This traffic is passing through the data plane. But while devices spend a lot of their time forwarding transit traffic, that's not all they do. Routers deal with routing protocol traffic. Switches respond to ARPA requests. And everything needs to be managed with SSH, SNMP, HTTP, or some other protocol. These types of traffic are sent to or from a switch or router, not through it. This is not transit traffic. Instead, this is called exception traffic. Network devices need to receive, process, and reply to exception traffic. This is handled in the control plane. Sometimes you'll hear the term management plane. This is just referring to the management traffic to or from a device. This is really just a part of the control plane. The device uses its CPU to process control plane traffic. For example, a router may receive OSPF traffic from a neighbor. This is exception traffic. These updates are processed by the router's CPU to determine the best paths to each network and to update the routing table. The data plane, on the other hand, does not use the CPU. Routers and switches will use special hardware to forward the traffic quickly and efficiently. Why are routers and switches designed this way? There are a few reasons. One is to separate these main functions completely. If a router gets overwhelmed with traffic and the CPU hits 100%, the router may not be able to process any more exception traffic. The data plane, however, will still be able to forward transit traffic. I've actually seen this myself, where a switch would continue passing traffic, but I couldn't SSH to it at all. This was simply because of a failure in the control plane. The users connected through the switch were blissfully unaware that there was even an issue. This separation is something that Juniper seems to pride themselves on. It was one of their major design goals when they were creating Junos. We'll see how they've done that in this video and the next. You got a break from quizzes in the last video, but that's over now. I would like to stress how important it is to understand the split between the control plane and the data plane, and the difference between exception traffic and transit traffic. As you go through the rest of this video, please pay close attention to these concepts. Let's start by looking at this router. It has a few interfaces or ports. Packets flow into one interface, called the ingress interface, and flow out of another interface, the egress interface. Inside the router, we can see that it is divided into two parts. One is called the routing engine, or RE, which handles exception traffic. The other is the packet forwarding engine, or PFE, which handles transit traffic. The RE is the component that handles control plane traffic. The PFE is the data plane. The PFE is, practically speaking, the line cards that contain interfaces where our cables are connected. In a Juniper system, they're called FPCs, or flexible PIC concentrators. FPCs may be built into a switch or router, or there may be a separate module that has been added to increase the number of available ports. More accurately, the PFE includes not only the line card, but also includes the firmware that controls it. Packets that transit the device ingress and egress through the PFE. There is likely to be more than one FPC in a system. Inside the switch, These are connected through a switch fabric. A packet may ingress on a port, be forwarded across the fabric to a new FPC, and egress out another port. So the data plane includes the FPCs as well as the internal fabric that connects them. Can you see how the data plane is isolated from the control plane here? The RE has a few tasks. One of these is to run Junos. The RE contains the Junos kernel and runs the processes that manage chassis resources. We'll take a look at the processes in the next video. So we can see that another task of the RE is to manage the chassis, which includes monitoring its health. This includes checking temperature, fan speed, alarms, packet counters, and so on. It also has a two-way relationship with the PFE. For one, the PFE provides it with raw data, enabling it to monitor things like packet counters and errors. But also, the RE needs to manage the PFE, including pushing microcode down to the FPCs and making sure it has an up-to-date copy of the forwarding table. And of course, the routing engine needs to live up to its name by participating in routing protocols, building the routing table, and maintaining the forwarding table. We'll see more of that soon. You might be familiar with the term supervisor, as used by other vendors. This is roughly the same thing as the routing engine. Larger devices will have two routing engines for backup, as well as to support in-service software upgrade. This is a way of updating Junos without impacting traffic flow. There's more on this in the study notes if you're interested. Modern routers have advanced this concept of control plane and data plane split considerably. It improves performance, but sometimes it can blur the lines between the two planes. The RE is generally responsible for handling exception traffic, that is, traffic sent to or from the router. Traffic would arrive at an ingress interface, flow through the PFE, and up to the RE. The RE would process the traffic. If it needs to respond, it will send the traffic back to the PFE, which will forward it out the egress interface. Now consider this example. Traffic arrives at the router, but the router does not have a route for this traffic and therefore can't forward the traffic. The router would then need to create and send an ICMP message back to the sender. As this traffic comes from the router itself, you would think this is handled by the RE. However, on a modern Juniper router, this function is offloaded to the PFE. This lightens the load on the RE. Other features that are offloaded to the PFE include quality of service, policing, and stateless firewall filtering. There's something interesting about the way that the RE and PFE interact. If you're completely new to Juniper, this might seem a bit foreign. Inside the router, there is a special link that connects the RE hardware to the PFE hardware. This comes with a special interface, which on an MX router is called FXP1. Other platforms might call it EM1 or some other name. For the purposes of this video, we'll just call it FXP1. This acts as a small switch between the RE and PFE components. When the PFE needs to send exception traffic to the RE, it will send it over this interface. Transit traffic will not pass over this interface. The bigger systems that have two REs will have two interfaces, FXP1 and FXP2. Oh, and don't get these mixed up with FXP0, which is a management interface. We do not need to configure FXP1 at all. We don't need to configure IP addresses, unit numbers, families, or any of it. This is all managed internally by Junos. This link has a built-in rate limiter. This limits how much traffic can be pushed from the PFE to the RE. This limiter is here as a protection against denial of service attacks. We can't configure the rate limiter ourselves, however, we can create our own firewall filter to further limit traffic to the RE. For example, we might apply a filter to allow BGP traffic from known peers, but deny BGP traffic from any other peer. We'll take a look at firewall filters in video 18. This leads us into considering how routing and forwarding works with this split between the RE and the PFE. Routing information, such as OSPF or BGP, comes from neighbor routes. This is an example of exception traffic and needs to be handled by the RE. The RE will take this information, along with static, connected, and local routes, and it will build the routing table. The routing table, also known as the Routing Information Base, or RIB, contains valid routes to reach destination networks. This is maintained by the RE, so you can think of the routing table as part of the control plane. The RE will take all the best routes from the routing table and will use them to build the forwarding table. The forwarding table is also known as the Forwarding Information Base, or FIB. The RE will push a copy of the forwarding table to the PFE. Using this table, the PFE can make forwarding decisions for transit traffic without consulting the RE. We can see then that the forwarding table is part of the data plane. Do you see the distinction between the routing table and the forwarding table? The routing table contains all valid routes and is stored in the RE. The forwarding table contains the best routes and is stored in both the RE and the PFE. The forwarding table is more than just Layer 3 routes though. It also contains Layer 2 and Layer 1 information. This is so the PFE knows which destination MAC and interface to use for egress traffic. This model, along with specialised hardware, makes forwarding very fast. How did you go with the control plane and data plane concepts? Do you understand how the RE and PFEs fit into the larger picture? It was challenging to create a lab for this video, but if you're interested, head over to the member section of the website and check it out. Junos is a bit different under the hood compared to, say, Cisco's iOS. It uses an entirely different approach to operating system design. Click the video shown here to learn more.